Another question, you get it often, but it's going to be one of those times. So, how do you know the difference between astral projection and imagination?
Okay, that is really a long, long discussion, but let's see if I can make it a short answer that's perfect. Imagination and astral projection. Short story. Imagination comes from image. An image is what we create in thought. We can talk about an image online, but we're talking about mental image or thought image, our image that we create. So we imagine it, the process of creating an image that we can see. We call it imagining, and we call it using our imagination to create the image. But the image is 3D, holographic, and a person can get inside their image. So the image is projected all around a being. Now, Agbila, you could do that right now if I said, imagine being in a spaceship right now.
I'm there.
Okay, describe it and look behind you and describe just a quickie description here.
There's huge ass, like big, darker, like grayish doors behind me. I guess that's, warehouse or whatever. Lounge on the right and a few more beings on my left.
A lounge, say a lounge area on the
Yeah,
right.
yeah.
You see people walking around in there?
I should count it more, but yeah, there's one. There's one there sitting on a
Okay.
stool.
Okay, now look, kind of imagine in your imagined, and we can talk about whether it's real or imagined or what it is exactly in a minute, but now looking down in your imagined world, what do you see that you're standing on or sitting on or whatever?
It's like floor. Like some kitchens have marble square floors, and I have like military pants.
No, you have military pants on?
Yeah,
Okay. Did you have combat boots or what do you have for shoes?
combat boots.
Okay. Are they black or brown or whatever?
Black.
Okay. Good. Now look above you and what do you see?
There's like a few more floors going with the rails, and it's quite a big place.
Okay, it's like a big open space like that. And there's like a lounge where people can hang out and stuff over there. Okay. On board a spacecraft. Okay. Now see, this is Ogvila's imagination. And she's particularly good at this. Give yourself a moment if you need it to get it as clear as you can. We want to rate it 1 to 0 to 10 on a visual scale of vivid clarity. Not a
If
test.
I'm open, I mean, if I would close my eyes,
Yeah, go ahead, close your eyes for a minute because it's not a test or anything. I just want to let people know how it works for you.
yeah, it's 10 right now, and I'm going for 11 where I can see their energy. I got it. Yeah, 11.
Wow. So if physical reality, if you look around your room right now or wherever you are watching this, and you go, okay, this is physically real, this is this vivid and touchy-feely. Well, we won't talk about touchy-feely right now. We look at the imagery of it. This would be a 10. For me, this is my 10. This is what 10 looks like. Now, when you get out of body, it's more real than a 10. I mean, for some people it's a 10, some people it's an 8, 7, 6, depends on how awake you are in the moment you're out of body. But and there's a few other factors that can play in. People, when they visualize stuff, they're somewhere between 0 and 10 on the scale. Is your visualization 3D all around you, and you can see it crystal clear with all the details? That's a 10. Akvila can do that all day long, and she can jack it up to 11, and she's been at 12, and I think higher before.
Pretty much, like when I close my eyes, I sort of crouch a little and like touch the marble floor so I can feel the cold of the marble. So it's like it's pretty real here and there.
Yeah. So this is imagination. So what happens is that our imagination kind of approaches that the definition of what is real. then what is real is a whole philosophical question. It becomes a big conversation too. But we're just talking about the imagination right now. So this is vivid imagination that you can touch and feel. So what makes something, and then we're going to talk about astral, how does this relate to an astral experience? It's hard to say until you understand what the imagination is and what it does and how it works. Because it's our imagination that creates reality, this physical reality and any other reality experience. It's experienced by our imagination. So it goes like this. So Agvila imagines this. In other words, she creates it with thought. And whether she's tuning in to something that she created earlier in thought, or she's tuning into something that somebody else created in thought, and thousands or millions of others tuned into the original thought and created together that imaginary place. It's like imagining something together. So you get a bunch of psychic people like Agvila in one room and say, hey, let's create a thing. And everybody closes their eyes, and they don't even have to close their eyes. They're like freaky like that. And just like, okay. And then they start seeing another place, and they tune into each other's stuff so that they're tight and they're on the same wavelength, and they literally telepathically are tuned, and they are all seeing the same thing. So when a person over here, not Agvila, but somebody over here, imagines a tree and go, oh, who did that? The tree will pop into place. Oh, hey, who did that? Well, cut it out. No. but there'll be agreements in place, whether it's spoken or just kind of generally we get it. And this tree, maybe everybody will see it, maybe everybody won't. Maybe you have to get everybody's agreement. Maybe that's the agreement. You know, if we all agree that something is here, then it's here. And then a big discussion, and then go like in an instant, hey, how about we put a tree here? And everybody says yes, except one person says nope, no tree. So everybody will see the tree over there because they've imagined it with the original creator, imaginary tree maker person. So everybody sees the tree, and it looks exactly the way the originator wanted it to look, except this one person. I don't see a tree. No tree there. Well, this person has not agreed to see what everybody else sees just because they see it, imagine or think it and believe it. It's there. Not me. No. But then this one person isn't in tune with everybody else and has chosen not to be. But as soon as they say, okay, I'll agree. I see what everybody else sees and makes, and we all create it together. Yeah, okay, I agree. And boom, tree will pop up. And now this person that didn't see the tree pops up. But not only do they tune in on a wavelength, concept, idea, thought, idea thing. This person has to imagine on automatic, instantly, the tree also. So this person has to imagine the tree in order to see it, or they won't see it. So it's kind of like that with reality, this physical world. Everybody here is imagined. Somebody created the original construct, and then we play the time game of consecutive experience, domino effect, cause and effect sort of thing, where you plant a little seed and it'll grow into a big tree, you know, and we all agree on the time. So we don't see the tree instantly because we've all agreed that in this reality system, we track time together linearly, boom, 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 boom. So we get to see things change over time. Mountains and trees and rivers, they change over thousands and thousands of years. And it's like, okay. So it goes slow in that way. But we are still imagining it, and we're tuned in to the agreements that we've made on a subconscious level. And now we're like hardwired, hardcore, connect with those beliefs. And people who can levitate in this world, they're not hardwired, connected to those kinds of beliefs in their imagination. So they can imagine that they can fly, and then they can. Their imagination becomes real, and it manifests in this physical world faster because they believe it can. And that's how rich people get rich. They believe in themselves and they don't go along with the social group. They follow a lot of the rules, but they also do that law of attraction magic using their imagination. So anyway, reality is created through thought, tuned in together. And the thought is images, and the image is imagined, and the imagined image of reality, the thought of how reality is the imagination. So all experience is imagination. So to answer the question, is an astral, how, what's different about the astral experience instead of imagination? I get the simple question. Did I really have an out-of-body experience, or did I really have an astral travel, or did I just imagine that I did? Well, knowing what you know now, it's like the entire astral experience was in your imagination. But so is being here, and so is an out-of-body experience. You come back, oh, I just had an out-of-body experience. Or was that my imagination? Well, it's all in your imagination. So it was imaginary. So the real question to be asking is, was it real? Okay, I get it. It's all in my imagination. Okay, but was it real? Did I really have an astral travel? Well, reality comes with agreement. The first agreement is you're agreeing with yourself. I agree. I had an astral experience. Now, you don't need anybody else's agreement. But if you're a little wishy-washy and you don't know, and so you want to go checking around, you know, hey, I did this and I did that, and I can't tell if it was my imagination or if it was a real astral experience. Really? It's whatever you agree to. And what we agree to, whether it was a real astral travel experience or not, is based upon a whole level of beliefs. How many beliefs do you have about, you'd have to ask yourself, how would you know if an astral experience is real or not? And it's either going to be, you can answer it two ways, like, well, I really don't know. That's one answer. The other one is, I would have to study up on it and ask somebody like Rich if it's real or not. And I'd be going, I really don't know. What's real? And then you'd go, oh, that's a bullshit answer. I want the real answer. Oh, you want the real answer? Okay, the real answer is you'd have to define for yourself what is an astral experience. And then you'd have to go as far as going, well, how would you know what is an astral environment for you? Well, you know, really, I don't even know what the astral is. Oh, and then you got to back up. This is if you're taking a hard dive into what the hell just happened, right? You take a look at what is the astral realm. An astral realm, astral comes from a star, astral. So it's the realm of the stars, you might say. Astral travel is traveling into the stars. In other words, you go out of body and you travel into the stars, but you're not traveling in the physical universe. You're traveling in the other astral plane, but it's just a label. But there you are, you're traveling in this realm. And it's like, ooh. And when you go out in there, it's touchy-feely. You feel it. You feel alive. You find planets, you land on the planets or planes or belief system territories, you'll shift and you'll find yourself with people. Now, I say you're with people. How touchy-feely is it? It's very touchy-feely. Well, does it feel as real when you touch it, like a wall, a brick wall or something? Does it feel as real to you right now while you're in the astral, touching it, in your astral traveling? Does it feel as real as a physical wall? And you go, yeah, it does. Well, then that's real enough. It's real. So your astral travel is real. But to say, well, isn't it just imaginary? That's like say, is it orange? The question doesn't really fit right now. Is it a brave wall? That's a stupid. No, you didn't ask a stupid question. Sorry. Jeez, that's a stupid question. Shut up. Come on. It's not gonna. Of course, it was real. It was asshole. It was. No, we're not. What I'm saying is, when you're in your experience, if you can touch it and feel it, and just feels real enough to you as real, and you come back, you can say, that was real. It was real to me. And of course, it was in your imagination, and it was created with your imagination. Now, did you create it with others, or was that all your own creation? Did you tune into an astral realm or a belief system territory that was all yours? You did it all yourself, subconsciously or consciously. Or did you tune into something that other people were already creating? They've created a reality system or a belief system territory or an energy system, a plane, a dimension, a density, a vibrational frequency, all, you know, and you just tuned in. There's unlimited, there's millions and millions of those, trillions. And you tune into one. Wow, this looks real, feels real to me. And then you get back to your physical world. And if you have a clear definition for what an astral travel experience is for yourself, then you can go, I had that. Does it fit my definition? If you don't have a definition, more basically, it's your belief. Your belief of what an astral experience is. And if you absolutely don't know, Rich, I was just asking, you know, hey, I don't know. If you had an experience and you're running around and it's not in the physical world, and you're awake and aware and you know that you're not in the physical world running around, and you can really feel it and hear it and touch it and all that, it was either what is labeled an astral travel, astral projection, consciousness shift into another realm, an out-of-body experience, or phase shift. They're all labels for the same thing. You're awake, aware, alive, running around, touching, looking at shit, and you're not in the physical world. If you know that, then you get back here and you just give it a label. And you would call it an astral projection. Technically, you can call it astral traveling if you're traveling in what you've decided is the astral plane. But if you're calling this just a belief system territory, it's just a territory, realm, built by beliefs of the people who are in that realm. So if you're calling it a belief system territory and you're in that belief system territory, you belief system territory traveled. You didn't astral travel, you see. Yep. But if you get out of body and you go through your house and you go up toward the stars and you're into the stars and and you're seeing stars and you traveled, you go, you know, definition, astral travel. I traveled to the stars out of my body. Yeah, astral traveled. That's what that was. Interesting. But if you're not really sure, you think, you know, I just imagined it. Of course you imagined it, but how real did you imagine it? Imagine it. If you didn't imagine it powerfully enough, consciously or subconsciously, to convince yourself, so you can't agree to your definition of what astral travel means and is as an experience, then you can go, pfft. I've seen people talk to people. They've had the best out-of-body experience in the world. I can't believe it. How do you it gets back to that, you know, so what do you believe? What do you want to believe? And we're able to change our beliefs all the time. Look at, you know, what's it take to believe this was an out-of-body experience? What's it take to believe this is an astral travel experience? And then you make your, if you have to go that well to get it and nail it. But on the other side of all that, what this is really about, it's not about the labels. It's about the experience. Now, if you have an experience and go, whoa, I'm here and this is real. I'm really here. You get back and you don't have to ask if it was astral, whether it was your imagination or nothing. You can go, whoa, I did it. Don't know what to call it, but I did it. That's a good thing. And just, you know, stay focused, do it again, learn how to do it again and again and again. And it'll come to you after a while. You'll figure it out and you'll put labels on it for yourself. I hope that. Oh. Yeah, that was a short answer.
That's a lot. Wow.
Yeah, and thanks for asking, because it was a good opportunity to share my thoughts on that whole subject. And it's really okay to have other a different understanding of it. And there are many teachers that do. Teachers that are into consciousness and the mind and spiritual development and getting out of body, and different people are going to have different understandings of these things. And that's a great thing. We all get to choose what we're going to have for lunch. Okay. So thanks.
You sure know a lot.